So thanks to the other people, to Derek and Misha for giving me the chance to speak here. So it's actually always nice to be back at ITEM, so to get a chance to come here. And before I start, I also want to thank all the people that are actually doing the work in Dresden at the moment. And in fact, so all or the core of what I'm going to talk about here has all been done by one really great PhD student in the last year, or so a little bit less than the last year. All right, so maybe like now trying to connect to what we have heard about already today and yesterday is actually all these great experiments, how you use interactions of light with a single scatterer actually by strongly confining the light. So in cavities, so all these nanostructures that we have heard about so nicely this morning. And now what I'm trying to, or what I will talk about is also like a way to achieve strong photon interactions on the quantum level, but using a kind of an opposite approach, so where we don't use single scatterers, but we go over to many scatterers in a large extended ensemble. And in this way, of course, you lose your nonlinearities typically, right? Now you have like many photons, there's no tight focusing, and you have many more atoms or any sort of scatterers than you have photons. So there's no nonlinearity, but we get them sort of back by now looking at situations where we have very strong interactions, so state-dependent interactions between your matter systems. And in this way, if you get long-range interactions, then the hope is also that these things would behave quite differently than sort of these local situations, so you can get distant sort of non-local non-linearities. All right, so how, in practice, how do we get these interactions in experiments? It's essentially still using atoms, but you go to very, very highly excited states. So these highly excited Rydberg atoms, everyone, I think, knows about. And the main property is actually that these guys become very big. So this is really here sort of a two-scale drawing of the electronic density. So this is hydrogen in the 1s state, 2s, 3s, 4s. And you see already here, so it's blowing up quite dramatically. And then typically in experiments, you can go all the way up to 100 or even more in some cases. And the main thing that we are sort of caring about here is this enormous scaling of the interaction strength, so the van der Waals interaction strength with n. And the consequence of this is shown here in this plot that's usually shown, where you see now indeed if you take rubidium and you go from the 5s ground state to the 100s excited Rydberg states, you are gaining 12 orders of magnitude in the interaction strength. And this is really now changing the whole excitation dynamics, and as you could see the sort of optical response of such a gas in a very strong way and on distances of several micrometers. All right, so now the second ingredient that we will use is again something everyone knows here very well. So we will drive the system in a sort of in this three-level configuration such that you form a dark state now composed of this S spin wave excitations and your photon as shown here. And this dark state now will now propagate ideally without any dissipation or refraction, but with a much, much reduced group velocity, which then also allows you to squeeze in even like fairly long pulses into the small media here. All right. And that's shown here, so that's a typical absorption or transmission spectrum, if you wish, as a function of sort of this two-photon detuning here. And you see there's this very, very narrow transmission window on the order of this energy scale here, so the EIT window. And the idea is now that I can essentially do the same thing with this ladder type scheme because the lifetime of my Rydberg state here is very, very long and typically I can neglect it. So this ladder scheme is essentially equivalent to this lambda type scheme that has been usually considered. So then in the end, I see already from this fairly narrow line width here that this EIT is a very sensitive effect, so which makes it hard sometimes in experiments to get nice EIT, but in our case it's actually a good thing because now you can easily perturb this EIT by your interactions. Right, and that's kind of now the name or the main point of this talk, and that's kind of the outline for the rest of what I will be talking about. So first I try to give you like a more simple picture of why this is actually a pretty promising or great approach to induce now stronger dissipatively, but then in the second talk I try to make a case and point out some problems that this is actually not as great as every one of us thought it would be a few years ago. And then in the end, I show you a potential solution by which you can fix some of these problems and maybe really get this interaction induced nonlinearity on a level that it might be useful for some applications. All right. Now to give you a simple picture, so now you could sort of use this kind of a classical or semi-classical picture by which you just imagine two atoms being at a distance, and I'm driving them now by this classical field and this quantum field, or could also be a weak classical field. And now if I'm on two-photon resonance, so this small delta here is zero, then these two atoms independently form this dark state, and they don't really talk to the probe photon that's coming in on this transition. But now as I'm bringing them in, they will see these strong interactions here, and then I'm moving out sort of from my EIT to photon resonance, and eventually at very, very small distances, I'm entering the limit where these two atoms, or one of the atoms, essentially behaves like a two-level medium. Then I get strong absorption and strong reflection. And that's essentially the idea of this whole scheme. And since you start at zero, so any change here will be enormous. So you always get very strong interactions. So now, if you want to have this in a bit even more cartoonish way, so essentially how one can picture this is that if I'm sending in one photon into such a cloud of three-level ladder-type atoms, then I'm forming this this region here. Okay, so this I forget. So essentially, we can also estimate the range of this potential by knowing the interactions and the features of your EIT, and then you essentially get that the crossover from sort of non-interacting to strong two-level response is actually set by this interaction being equal to twice the EIT line width because you have two photons involved. And that's typically, as I said in the beginning, it can be on the order of 5 or even up to 10 micrometers in experiments. All right, so then this is what happens. So this photon then establishes this blockade sphere around it, where the excitation that it's dragging along now turns this its vicinity into a two-level medium, which now has a strong optical response, and that means any other photon that's coming by will actually see the presence of this photon at this large distance here mediated by the interactions. Okay, so this has been put forth quite some time ago, and now there are many beautiful experiments also here in Cambridge in Misha's, Vladan's group, and Sebastian's experiments, who will talk about this tomorrow. Yeah, essentially, most of the experiments are exploiting sort of few-body interactions, two- or three-body interactions, and really already demonstrating all of the main or major effects that have been predicted so far, as I said, in a dissipative regime, but also in a coherent regime where you can entangle photons and so on and so forth. It's also interesting, in fact, already if you look at this from a classical level, I would say, so you get these very long-range and non-local non-linearities that are also of interest for sort of classical nonlinear optics community. And in the end, so that's probably one of the main goals of all these endeavors, you could imagine to do some many-body quantum optics involving many photons talking really over large distances with each other. And as you see here, sort of these three regimes, if you wish, they are controlled on the one hand by your intensity of light that you are sending in, but then also by something what we call the optical depth. So this will be this ODB that you see in the second, and that's essentially the fraction of light that's being absorbed by one of these blockade spheres, sort of this volume that's turned into a two-level medium. All right, and so as I said, so tomorrow there will be actually many talks on this. Alexei will talk more, I think, about more like complicated physics in this sort of many-body regime. You will hear about experiments, so that's why I will focus actually on the most simple situation that you can imagine that's very simple to treat on the theoretical side. And that's essentially the case where we will just be looking at two photons, and make it even simpler, just assuming that we first take one photon and store it inside this medium. So this photon is gone, it's completely immobile, and all what it's doing is it's changing its environment, so wherever it sits, into these two-level atoms. And then all we'll be asking is basically how does the second photon propagate through the medium here. So that's, as I said, it's very simple. You can sort of answer this question in a few lines. So then you can describe now this electric field amplitude of this propagating photon by a linear simple equation here, where all the sort of interaction effects are contained here in this linear response of the medium. And that's what's plotted here. So this would be on resonance. So if I'm driving my probe field on resonance of the lower two-level system, and here you see the real part in green, and the red in red shows the imaginary part of the system. And you see that sort of on the scale of the blockade radius, I suddenly turn my system into strongly absorptive from fully transparent. So that means once this photon is going through, it will most likely be fully absorbed. So then, as you can think, you can now play with this detuning and actually tune the ratio of these two things. So that's shown here when the decay rate is equal to your single photon detuning, you have both dissipative and coherent interactions being the same, and then I can turn them around. So then for large detunings, I can actually get coherent interactions, and then you might think of doing phase gates, for example, with these things. So that brings me to the two applications that are really now being pursued in experiments, and people have thought about quite a bit. So on the one hand, you can do the more simple situation where you say, I'm going on resonance, I get the strongest interactions, and use this as some kind of single photon transistor where you store one spin wave, and eventually you can block all the other photons that are coming afterwards, or you go off resonance, like in this case where you now hope to get a sort of a conditional phase shift of having two photons coming in with the same polarization. All right, so now let me go through these things, and as I said, so trying to point out some problems that eventually arise there, and start with this two-photon phase gate situation. So just to go through it again, so what we will look at is we take a photon, store it in this medium here, then come in with another photon, and then we get these effects of the Rydberg interactions in the medium by which, like the spin wave and the photon will pick up a phase. Right? Then I read it out again, and in an ideal world, they will have picked up both the phase and nothing else happened. So this is what we would like to have. And as I said, so what you want to do is you want to tune the state far out of resonance. But as you see again, so there's no free lunch as always. And that's a problem you can never avoid for these two-level systems, that if I now increase the ratio between the coherent interactions and the dissipative interactions, like every one of them, of course, also goes down. And in the end, if I now express my losses in terms of the phase shift, you see that basically I need to have a very, very large optical depth for a given phase to suppress my losses. That's still okay, so you could say, you know, I do high densities and long-range interactions, but as you see, so the demands, if I now put this in and require a pi phase shift, the demands on this optical depth are actually quite high. And it turns out, so this recent experiments have shown this, that there's also some kind of fundamental limit where basically what happens is that when you go to higher and higher densities, now suddenly also your ground state atoms at these high densities start to sort of interact or talk to the Rydberg atom, and that leads to very strong dephasing. And so typically the way it looks at the moment, so kind of a useful bound of this optical depth here would be around 10 or 15 if you work with these standard van der Waals interactions. And if I look at these numbers, so it's still a reasonably nice phase shift of 0.5 or 0.6, but that's really in the ideal world. So, and you will never really, at least if you don't overcome these limitations, you couldn't really get this to the point where things become useful. All right, so then you could say, okay, so if there is a lot of dissipation, let me just use it and not worry about these coherent interactions. So you can look at these single photon or optical transistor applications. And I think tomorrow we will hear a lot more about this in Sebastian's talk. Then here we essentially do the same thing. So we store a spin wave, which I now denote by some operator C. So this would destroy the spin wave. And now if I'm on resonance, this will now induce very strong absorption. And if I'm sending another bunch of photons into this medium, all of them will be scattered and none of them get through. And that kind of gives me, at least it gives me a switch. Right? However, what you would actually like to do, like similar to what has been proposed and being done in cavity QED, is to sort of map the state sort of with n incoming photons and either having or not having a spin wave to this entangled state, sort of where, sort of depending on the state, I'm sort of destroying the photons. That's what you like to have. However, as you can see already here, so from the strong absorption, because I'm scattering all these photons, I will actually turn this output state this has been demonstrated, so I forgot this experimentally, both in Stuttgart and Sebastian's group and at MPQ and Gerhard Rempel's group, and they really show pretty good numbers on this sort of extinction fidelity. So you can really block, if you have a spin wave, you can block all of the photons that you go in. But as I said, so you, like the scattering that you exploit to get this very strong absorption now also, of course, turns your state classically, because if you have a scattering event, you eventually know that you actually have a spin wave. So you don't have this, you don't create this entangled state, but you get a classical mixture of these two states. So it's essentially more like a classical switch than an actual sort of quantum transistor working on a single photon level. So that's one problem. That's something you would never be able to avoid, I think, if you sort of exploit scattering, incoherent scattering. But there's also another problem, which I now briefly want to go through, is essentially that you not only gain information of whether the spin wave has been there or not, but you actually also gain information on where your spin wave has been sitting. And that's, so you get spatial information. That's what I want to show here now. So this is a simulation, essentially, now of this situation where we have initially a completely delocalized Rydberg spin wave in the medium, and it's sort of its density matrix is shown here. So on the diagonal, you see the density distribution of this spin wave containing a single excitation, and then of course this off diagonal. So in this region here, you see the off diagonal elements of the density matrix, so the coherence of the spin wave, which of course you need if you want to retrieve it afterwards. And now in this part here, you will see now as you will see the photon pulse propagating through the medium, and these different lines essentially correspond to different possibilities, like in this plot, where my spin wave can sit. Right? So either I can have it here or here or here. So basically, it's, in practice, it's delocalized over the whole medium. And if you run this now, you see the following. Okay, so now you have to choose to either watch this or this. But essentially, so here you see the photon being propagating through the medium, and I show these different contributions. So every contribution, depending on the spin wave position, gets pretty much absorbed, very much localized around these lines, as you see here. Right? And okay, so if you watch this part, now you can look up again, and then simultaneously, as you see what's happening, sort of my coherence of the spin wave gets diminished very strongly as the photon comes through, and in the end, I get something which is which is also very close to a classical state, so very much localized to this diagonal here. And one can easily understand this by basically looking what's happening in these two regions. So apparently there are two different regimes here. So if you are sort of in this regime, so far inside the medium, basically what happens is that if a photon scatters at a given time, then I know with almost 100% probability, so apart from single photon losses, that this has been caused by a Rydberg excitation, so by the spin wave, and this spin wave consequently has to sit sort of a blockade radius away from it. So this scattering event will eventually localize my spin wave to a very, very narrow region. And that's why you see the stripe here. And on the other hand, in this region here, you get scattering at the entrance of your medium, and then I have an uncertainty of the size of the blockade radius where my spin wave can sit. So here's a small sort of window of opportunity, if you wish, where you actually wouldn't lose sort of this nice coherence properties of your stored spin wave. So that would mean eventually, if you really want to get the photon back, what you have to do for having at least a working classical switch, you need to make your medium sort of on the order, or with a size on the order of this blockade radius. But that again means that I need large optical depth, or blockaded optical depth, in order to actually even write and read my spin wave in the first place. So we get exactly the same constraint that we had for the phase gate, namely that you need a large OD, and again you see here typically around between 5 and 10, your fidelities aren't that great. All right, so this was kind of trying to make a case that there are some problems still remaining, although still you can do pretty nice things with these systems, and it's pretty obvious where these problems are coming from. So it's essentially the point that sort of we start from our very nice sort of dark states that don't dissipate and propagate slowly, and we use the interactions to actually destroy these dark states, and then it's eventually these two-level systems that are bringing in all the problems that you fight with. Right? And so you which essentially means, now ideally what you would like to have, maybe some kind of mechanism where you can now use your interactions to sort of switch, or that was actually the idea that we looked at, so where you switch from a certain type of dark state polariton now to another type of dark state polariton, which has different, so drastically different properties, But none of them, basically all of them are dark, so there won't be as much coherence or decoherence as you would have for these two-level systems. So that's what we try to do. And here's one way sort of you can think of. There might be other ideas sort of deriving from this, but so this is the simplest situation that we looked at. And now you first start essentially from the standard EIT setting involving three low-lying states. So this could be some two hyperfine states and the first excited states. And this will give me like a white propagating dark state polariton, as we looked at on the first slide of the talk. So now what I'm adding to it is essentially not much. So I take the same laser beam or sort of split it and shine it in from the other side, so that where you get this kind of now two coupled lambda systems. And here it's well known that basically this will lead to another type of dark state, which now has a different dispersion. So essentially like slow stationary light polaritons, which already also have been demonstrated experimentally. So what I'm doing now, essentially, I'm sort of I'm realizing a coupling between the right and the left moving photonic states, and this symmetric superposition of these two photonic components, they again form a dark state with no dissipation, but they now have a kinetic energy, so they won't propagate, but they slowly disperse in space only. All right, and the final step is now that, so there isn't any Rydberg interaction so far, the final step is that I now use sort of another coupling to the Rydberg state, so this is what's already present in the experiments, to sort of use this and take this Rydberg state essentially, as I show in a second, as a switch that will transfer me from this type of dark state polariton to this type of dark state polariton. And it might look a lot more complicated, but in fact all you do is you add this one additional classical laser field that is driving these low-lying transitions here. All right. So now without going into detail, so I just show you what happens if you now look at the photon propagation in this case. So basically now we look again at the case where I have a spin wave stored. In this case, it will be stored exactly in the middle of the medium. Here you will see the white in blue and the left moving photon in red propagating through the medium. Here you see the input field, so the amplitude at the input. This one will show sort of the amplitude of the left moving photon field, so the output on the left side, and this panel will show the output on the right side. And this is now the situation where I don't have a spin wave in the medium. And what you see is actually very boring. Okay, so it's a slow light. So essentially nothing happens, right? So the system just sort of this photon pulse propagates simply through the medium as if I just had a single simple three-level lambda system. And what's happening here is, of course, that because of this coupling to the Rydberg state, I'm forming these two duplets here, so that such that basically the left moving photon now experiences EIT, such that for the normal Rydberg EIT, so experience EIT on this transition here and gets completely decoupled from the right moving one. And if I'm just coming in from the left side, I will never populate the left moving photon, and it's just going through and doesn't see all the other stuff here. So I'm just getting this nice linear dark state or linear dispersion dark state polariton. If I now add the spin wave, now I get my interactions. So this shows the interaction region here. Then the following happens. So again, you get this right moving photon coming in. But then at this interaction region, you see that you populate now the left moving photon. And this is running off now with a very fast velocity. And eventually now there's no output on the right hand side. So it's like what you want for a transistor. And I get very high reflection basically to the left moving side, and the sort of the shape of this pulse is basically identical to the shape of the input pulse. So I get a very good reflector now just from this different level scheme I've showed you. So now how does this come about? So you can, just to summarize, so now we really have what we have, what we wanted. So there's a conditional reflection, so very similar like in cavity QED. I can now reflect my incoming photon conditional on the presence or absence of the spin wave, right? And then I can do all sorts of things afterwards that you want to do with these photons. So how does it work? So the mechanism is very, very simple. So parts of this I've already explained. So in this region where there's no spin wave, you just get these two sort of independent linearly propagating dark state polaritons. But however, now once I get into this interaction region, so essentially just at the edge, when I get in here, you are forming now these stationary light polaritons. Ideally, you only want to populate this branch here, where at low energies, your left and right moving photons are pretty much mixed 50-50, and they get stuck, right? And so here my dispersion is flat, so they get stuck, so they are sort of really sitting there for a very, very long time. And then eventually, after some time, sort of there is some slow dispersion, right? And so this will not really do a whole lot to the blue guy, so whenever the blue guy goes out, it will actually move back in. But so as soon as the red, so the left moving photon, goes out, gets transferred to this branch here, it will just leave the medium. And that's how this reflection works. So it's really very similar to a mirror. So here you can see that things actually work quite well. So if you look at the transmission properties in this non-interacting regime, you see that pretty much everything, like in terms of the performance of this propagation, only depends on the ratio of these two classical Rabi frequencies, so the Rydberg coupling and the lower lying control field. And typically you want to have this very, very large, but like numerically we find that basically already for having this about like twice or three times the lower Rabi frequency, we get a transmission spectrum which almost looks identical to the one that you get for standard EIT. So there are not very strong demands on this Rydberg excitation intensity, which usually is a problem in experiments, so that's nice. And if you look at the reflection spectrum, it's sort of equally nice, fortunately. So here you see a fairly low ODB, and that's now the reflection spectrum, and you see again, so this sort of has a nice flat feature. So on a similar scale than your standard EIT. So that means sort of it's like reasonably long or short pulses, if you would, you get almost no pulse distortion and very high reflection fidelities. All right, so that's almost all what I wanted to say. So let me just show like some actual numbers for the two applications that I've shown you in the beginning. So here again, you see the gate fidelity for these two photon interactions. So this was what you get for the standard setting. And if we now plot our reflection fidelity, now the square of this amplitude I've shown you before, so you see that you really get like quickly like fairly high numbers, and for typical values here we can get like above 80% already, simply because we don't have a whole lot of loss in the system. So there might also be ways to actually directly imprint the phase on these reflected photons, but that's just something we haven't really looked at in too much detail. If you now compare the performance of these optical transistors, you see, I mean, that's what you expect, that actually the absorption for the standard scheme, so where you just really sort of get full scattering, is slightly or significantly better, if you wish, than what you get for our conditional mirror. But in the end, if you take like numbers that are achievable, they're sort of giving you the same reflection or same reduction in transmission. But the important point is that I get this reduction in transmission without having a lot of absorption. So that's shown here. So here your absorption is 100%. In our case, it's very, very low. So below or on the order of like 10 or 5% for typical numbers. Okay, so with that, I want to finally show again what this means now for the spin wave. So you've seen this movie before. So on the left-hand side, there's the sort of the traditional approach. On the right-hand side, it's sort of the one that I just explained. And now I'm starting from a more localized spin wave, still extending over the whole medium, but now having some Gaussian shape. And again, if I sort of do this full scattering approach, I localize my spin wave very, very strongly. In the end, get this spaceship type shape here because of this block on the lower left corner. And so, which means I can almost not retrieve this, this spin wave at all. And now if I do it finally for the one based on reflection, that's for an ODB of 10, so a very reasonable number, you see that almost nothing happens to the spin wave. So there's a slight sort of deformation if you look closely, but essentially you can almost preserve the full coherence of your stored spin wave, which means I should be able to almost fully retrieve the spin wave at the end. All right, so I think that's pretty much all I wanted to say. So just to sum it up, so essentially what I try to show you is that by some minimal addition to current experiments, so essentially just adding some low-lying lasers that are also standard, you can actually drastically improve sort of the performance of at least few photon applications, so you get strong interactions, coherent interactions without inducing much dissipation. So essentially you can build very similar to cavity settings. You can build a single photon router without actually having a mirror, where your photons more or less act as a mirror itself. So you could use this for gates, as I said. You have now really a transistor working in the quantum regime. And in principle, you can also use it as a non-destructive measurement of your photons that you have, or of single photons that you store. All right, so what are the questions that we are looking at now so that it works for this very simple situation? So obviously, the next step would be to look at few or two-body dynamics to begin with, where we kind of expect and initial calculations suggest that this would work equally well if I'm now having two photons that are actively propagating in the medium, where now essentially one of the photons, so the first photon that is entering the medium, essentially acts like a mirror. So it's really shielding the medium from the remaining photons. And now instead of eating up the photons, you've seen it in experiments before, so you will just reflect other photons coming. So this now really works, or could be a nice way to, for example, act as a sort of photon subtractor. So you can subtract now a single photon. Or you can do both things. Right? So on the one hand, it will give you a nice single photon source, and the photon going through is not affected by these interactions at all, so you get a nice source of single photons. And on the other hand, you can also look at the output field on the left-hand side, where the medium would now act sort of like a single photon subtractor. But these are things we have to look into a bit more detail still. And then finally, of course, sort of the final goal would be to look at this in the sort of many-body or multi-photon regime, where the hope would be that sort of despite the fact that we don't really have real interactions between the photons, right? So as I said, so both states that we are switching between are dark state polaritons, so there's never really a refractive interaction, but the dispersion gets changed very much. And in a way, what we expect is that sort of the switching to this dispersive regime would again act like a reflector or like a photon shield, so the photons are still sort of pushing themselves apart, and maybe one would be able to see some ordered states as sketched here to form in the system as I'm sending photons through. So in particular, so we had looked at this recently at the standard situation, so we just have these shift-type interactions in a ladder system, as I explained in the beginning, and there you already see quite some interesting behavior on a multi-photon level. So if you drive the system in a stationary light configuration, so you see all sorts of different phases, correlated liquids, but also photonic crystals, so insulating photonic crystals. So now here you have a much more unconventional situation, and the hope would be that we see some interesting or more exotic physics possibly to arise from these type of interactions. All right, that's it. Thank you very much.
Question. So in the original gate, the arrow was, I guess, or the transistor, I guess they're, in this case, they're all the same, right? Once you're coherent, they're all the same, right? The gate and the transistor.
Yeah, it's the same, but so what, Mac?
So the arrow originally was one over the blocking of optical depth. I mean, it still probably scales the same, right? You just change the back three factor in front?
For which one? For the gate?
For the new state.
For the gate, not for the...
I mean, the same.
No, for the transistor, you get different scaling. You get exponential scaling.
Or,
yes. Yes, yeah. They scale your fidelity scales the fidelity scales exponentially, right?
You're saying the error is not 1 over OGD anymore? It's much better?
Yes, so our fidelities, they are not exponential. So this is what you actually can see. So they kind of go up. They come up very quickly initially, but...
If you go to the right and turn upside down, is the error 1 over ODB?
If I'm going where should I go?
To the right, and the...
No, this is a power law increase. So this goes roughly ODB over 1 plus ODB to the 2. That's a power law. It's not exponential.
So at large ODB, it doesn't go
It goes to 1, but it goes slowly to 1.
No,
but What do you call the error? It's like the number in the exponential.
The distance from one.
Yeah, but I mean, so this is not one over. No, it's not in this case. No,
it's not.
It's not. No. Oh no, it's actually not squared, right? As I said, so it's like the full error goes like ODB over like 1 plus ODB to the 2. It goes quadratic, basically, right? And here you get an exponential scaling, right? You get e to the minus, but then if you go up, you get 1 over, yeah, I understand what you're saying. Right? So this goes like 1 over ODB, and this goes actually like 2. 1 over ODB to the 2, like quadratic. Yes, but you get into this regime very, very slowly. I don't know. Maybe.
So about this localization, right? Like it's important if you have this delocalized spin wave to be able to retrieve it, that whatever you do not give you information about where it is.
Exactly.
And I sort of wonder if in this case it's either like somehow the transit time or the phase of this reflected light field doesn't give you some information about where, you know, how far in the photon penetrated.
Yeah, well, it's coherent, so basically, right? It doesn't affect the spin wave. So if you don't have any scattering at all.
Well, if I had a mirror and I was reflecting light off of it, I could figure out how far away the mirror was.
Okay, yes.
Right, by doing astrometry or looking at a time device. Right, and so now if I have a mirror in superposition of different places, I would
okay.
So, I wonder if
this same thing. No, I mean, yes, you do pick up a phase, of course, but the phase is flat. Right? So like every time, sort of, I mean, you pick up the phase from this sort of reflection event wherever you have your spin wave sitting, but like this is always the same everywhere. Right?
Isn't there a propagation phase too?
Yes, but that's a dark state, so it doesn't pick up a phase. Right? There's a zero response of the medium. I mean, so all things you see are bandwidth effects. So if you make the pulse longer, this will all go down. So there is a phase, but it's global. It doesn't hurt you. Yeah. Okay. Yes. Yes, yeah. It's just that you don't need a cavity in this case. Yes, yes. It acts like a cavity. Yes, 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 yes.